Welcome back. Ken Rosenthal leading the league. We were talking to Dongyoung Park about the Donaldson deal. And Kenny, for some more perspective, it really is quite an upset win for the Twins when you consider the traditional superpowers that were also among his suitors.
Right. And it was the Nationals, it was the Braves, it was the Dodgers to an extent as well. He signs for 4 years, $92 million. Again, we can repeat. Second largest contract ever for a player 33 or over. Donaldson is 34. Kevin Brown, largest for a player in that age bracket. 7 years, $105 million with the Dodgers in 1998. The Nationals, for a time, looked like they might upset the Braves here. The Braves were considered the favorite all along. They wanted Donaldson back. It figured to be a natural fit. Things really ended well there. But at the same time, for whatever reason, those teams did not bid high enough. And the Dodgers, my understanding was they were never in love with 4 years, not even so much with 3 years, so perhaps they were facing an uphill fight as well. But the Twins still qualify as an upset winner here. And the reason is, one, there are higher state taxes in Minnesota, so it makes it a little bit more difficult for them. They've got to go above and beyond other teams to get players. And also, it's not a place where you've traditionally seen free agent hitters go. There is a cold weather situation in April, sometimes September. And while Nelson Cruz has been greatly successful there, he was an older player on one-year deals toward the end of his career. This deal, the $92 million deal for Donaldson, is the biggest in Twins history. So it's a bit of a risk because of the age of the player and all of that. At the same time, this is the kind of guy that you want when you are trying to complete a championship roster. The question now is, what do some of these other teams do? Now, the Nationals, we know they were on plan B. We talked about this at length. They signed Asdrubal Cabrera. They signed Starlin Castro. They've got Carter Kieboom. They've got Kendrick. They've got a lot of ways that they can go. So their need for Donaldson diminished as the offseason went on, yet they're still without a big-time cleanup hitter to replace Anthony Rendon. And when you look at what has happened to them the last 2 years, first losing Harper, then Rendon, there are two significant hits to their offense. The bigger question might be Atlanta. Now, here's a team that's going to go into the season, unless something changes, looking at Austin Riley and Johan Camargo as their third baseman. Questions around both. Riley tailed off after that hot start. Camargo did not play as well in more limited playing time last season. But there is still an option out there, not just for the Braves, but also for the Dodgers, should they choose to pursue it. And that option is going to be Chris Bryant. Now, I say going to be, because his service time dispute with the Cubs, the grievance, I should say, is still not resolved. Why this is taking so long, I have no idea. Commissioner Rob Manfred completed his report on the Astros in a much shorter frame of time than this is going on with the Cubs and Bryant. But the bottom line is, when this dispute, the grievance, is settled, he'll be either under control for 1 year or most likely two, which is as it is right now. And at that point, do the Braves or the Dodgers trade for him? Perhaps they do. And of course, Arenado is out there as well. Arenado's not going to go to the Dodgers. The Rockies would never do that. Will the Braves be willing to entertain that conversation? Are they even willing to entertain the conversation on Bryant? Or do they just prefer to sit there with Riley and Camargo, missing the big bat of Josh Donaldson?
Best guess, there will or will not be a Bryant or Arenado deal completed prior to the World Series.
Best guess, both get traded before the World Series.
Wow.
I don't know that Arenado happens right away, but I believe by the deadline that if the Rockies falter again and they're not in contention and they do not trade him before, that yes, they will do it. Now, Bryant, the Cubs, we know, have been itching to shake up this roster for their new manager, David Ross. Now, they can bring back their current roster and have a really good team, but they seem to want a new, fresher dynamic. Bryant is the obvious guy to trade. He's turned down big money from them already. They cannot expect to sign him to an extension. He's most likely headed to the open market in 1 year or two. And for that reason, he would be an attractive guy to trade and get some young talent, pitching in particular, back in return.
But the Bryant deal is a big deal because it affects so many other young players coming on, you know, and that's
the service time issue.
Yeah, the service time issue is huge. It just is. You know, commissioner's had some major decisions this winter. When we look back,
this one's an arbitrator, Harold. Just to be perfectly clear on.
Okay, good. Yeah.
Let me ask both of you guys this same question. Do you think, and this is pure guess, do you think that when the Rockies extended Arenado on the 9-year deal that we reported and all celebrated last year, was there any doubt in their mind at the time about how long he'd actually served that deal? In other words, did they think, hey, let's just do this now?
I thought it was genuine.
Get the really PR was. Run, but really in the back of our minds, we're going to look for opportunities to move it before it gets to the op years.
Matt, they didn't look at it quite like that, but they had to know, they did know, that there was the potential for this to go south relatively quickly because they gave him the opt-out after the third year. Now it's down to 2 years. And this is why they at least have to entertain the conversation. 2 years of control, that's the same amount of control the Indians have over Francisco Lindor, the same amount of control the Cubs have over Chris Bryant. This is the time when you start listening on guys like that. And we also know that Arenado has yet to come out and say, I want to stay. Hasn't done that. And at the end of the season, he seemed frustrated. Remember, he had that comment about it feels like a rebuild. It was a comment that came in a broader conversation, but at the same time, his frustration was evident, and the team, doing its due diligence, just has to listen.
All right, so I want to throw a couple things in here at you, Ken. One, I'm just making a point. I think the opt-out thing is not going to happen. We continue to talk about these opt-out with players, whether it's Justin Upton.
What do you mean, he's not going to opt out?
No. I mean, it works for the pitchers, but position players are held to an age standard. And so you're going to sit there and go, Donaldson, I know he got $93 million, but he's 33. You know, so that, and we're going to look at that as like a historical thing. I just don't think that when you become a player and you're getting to that 31, the opt-out, you're going to get more money. It may work for pitchers. I don't think it works for position players.
Harold, I agree with you, but I don't know that the Rockies are looking at it that way. They have to be on guard here.
No, I agree.
That he does that.
Yeah, they have to look at this one. Here's my question we went to early on in the break. So the Twins signed Donaldson to this contract, and they're a sabermetric thinking front office. I mean, it's been real clear how they've been thinking. And the sabermetrics have shown they're not locking guys up long-term after a certain age because they're looking at years of service and age. But here comes Nelly Cruz, and he shakes up everything. And he goes out and he continues to produce, and now he's headed into his 40s. Did that influence them in going the extra year for Donaldson?
It's a great question, Harold. I don't know the answer. The Twins have not addressed this contract publicly yet, pending a physical, of course. But that is certainly something that should be asked at the news conference, and I'll be trying to ask that in the days ahead. Keep in mind, and I'm glad you mentioned Cruz, he's up after this year. He's 40 years old, up after this year. They're going to need a veteran stabilizer in that lineup once he is gone, assuming he is gone. And let's face it, that lineup has a lot of younger type players, Kepler and Polanco and Sano and all of these guys. And one reason they've been able to thrive is the presence that Cruz has had in it. Donaldson can step in and be that guy if Cruz departs. You see, again, this lineup, that is, I don't want to say a murderer's row, but it's pretty darn good.
It can hit.
No doubt. I mean, it was good last year. It got a lot better with the addition of Josh Donaldson, as we learned. And I guess if I might make just one suggestion to end the discussion, I think in order to maximize the eyeballs for a televised press conference, any time after 1 p.m. Eastern is really optimal viewing.
And why is that, Matt?
I just feel like that's the best time to do it. Everybody's awake. It really makes
people enjoy their lunch while they're watching.
It makes all kinds of sense to do it after 1 p.m. Eastern. I reiterate that. Another televised press conference.
That's killing the game.
They are killing the game.